Thanks everyone for coming to the workshop. I want to first start out by expressing my thanks to all the students of NEAS who basically took the lead on this and did all the organizational and thinking work for the workshop. So Savita, Krupa, Priya, Sumitra, and etc. I am going to chair the first session, which is called Talking With and Against Caste. We have three presentations. The first is by K. Satyanarayana, who probably needs no introduction, but I've been requested to briefly introduce the speakers. So Satyanarayana is, of course, an associate professor at FLU in Hyderabad, and he is well known as co-editor of the volume, a couple of volumes on Dalit writing from South Asia, and a number of other writings. We also have Gogu Shyamala, who is a philosopher, author, and poet in Telugu. She also comes from Hyderabad, and she has written prolifically short stories and other forms of writing. And she's also represented Anveshi and the Dalit Women's Forum in the World Conference Against Racism, which was held in Durban in 2001. She's also a member of Anveshi. And then we have a presentation. Satyanarayana is going to be speaking on freedom of expression versus casteist language. Shyamala is going to be speaking on evolving and emerging terms, perceptions, standpoint, and language in contemporary anti-caste movements in the Telugu states. And then we have a presentation by a group from Azim Premji University in Bangalore, Talking Caste in the Everyday, an Ambedkarite Perspective. So this is by Asim Siddiqui, who is a faculty assistant professor in philosophy at APU, and two of his MA students. A. Manasa and Hemant Kumar. So, everyone has about 20 minutes to make their presentations. I'll try to be a little strict on time so that we can keep time for discussion afterwards. I think what we'll do is have all the presentations in a row and then open to discussion after that. Okay, so I would like to invite Satyanarayana to come, please, and make his presentation.
So I'm very happy to be part of this deliberation. And I thank the organizers, and particularly the student organizers, for taking this initiative. And I'm also very happy that there are still some spaces in this country where we can debate some issues like this. Because increasingly, I stopped traveling now to Delhi and other places because there are no events held. Or even if they are held, they are canceled. And particularly on issues like this. So I'm happy that NEAS is still providing a platform to discuss something. I was just telling a friend that Bangalore is safer when compared to Hyderabad and Delhi and so on. So slightly at least there's some space. So I'm happy that this discussion is happening and there are still people interested in these kinds of issues. Yeah, talking about language of caste. So I was thinking of briefly discussing a particular issue that has come up in the context of a report submitted by Human Rights Watch report 2016. But my main focus is basically to look at the SCST Act 1989, which I think is an important kind of a document, historical document, in terms of textualizing the meanings of caste. It's a kind of very, very important document. The HRW report raises some issues in relation to that act, particular sections of that act. So in a way, if you look at the SCST Act 1989, you have many kind of meanings of caste you find in that. There is a certain effort to textualize what is the meaning of caste, caste distinctions, caste humiliations, caste discrimination, caste insults, caste violence, caste relations, caste inequalities, caste humiliations, and so on. So a number of kinds of these examples, it's like a inventory of those kinds of practices that you find in the text of that act. So my own suggestion is that Though it takes this form of violations of all these violations of human rights or violations of rights of individuals and so on, but I would like to think of this as a document which actually textualizes how to think of human dignity, that how to think of these communities as with dignified kind of human beings and so on. So on the one hand, it takes this form of violations of human dignity on various kinds, but it also kind of imagines that unless these communities become human, then there's no point of talking about civil rights and so on. And in fact, even if you think of the history of this particular act in terms of the early Untouchable Disabilities Act and then PCR Act, so those are acts where the language was in terms of disabilities. Caste is a custom or a social evil, and so that particular kind of an object called caste or a practice called caste imposed certain disabilities on communities. So the attempt is to state-driven welfare programs, measures, which will kind of undermine those disabilities. So that was the language used. But by the time SEST POA Act 1989 comes, so this whole assertion of the Dalit movement in terms of demanding recognition, respect, and dignity is something that. So my general argument is that this act really captures that particular idea emerged in the 70s and 80s and so on. So in that sense, it's a kind of a historical kind of a document. So in this report of the Human Rights Watch, there is a long section which is titled Stifling Dissent, Criminalization of Peaceful Expression in India, 2016. So this report is generally about India, human rights violations, and obviously JNU and all other violations of the BJP government, the sedition law, the defamation law, and all those laws which are kind of curbing free speech, and several other examples of human rights violations. So it makes a kind of a list of all those and their arguments made, examples given, and so on and so forth. So along with sedition law and 124A and 295A, hurting religious sentiments and so on, this report also refers to SEST Act. SEST Act is something that curtails free speech. SEST Act is also problematic. So it needs to be kind of revised and so on. So in a way that it's listed along with those kinds of rules and laws which are examples of criminalization of peaceful expression. So this is also listed as something that really criminalizes peaceful expression and so on. And this particular report refers to one section in the SEST Act. Can someone open that? Yeah, I just have that section to show you. It's not important, but you can take a look at it. So in the old 1989 Act 3110, so this particular section is objected to by the Human Rights Watch. So that is the inventory when I mentioned. So that is 10.3.1.10. Intentional insults or intimidates with intent to humiliate a member of. Member of a scheduled caste or a scheduled tribe in any place within public view. So this is a particular kind of a section that HRW objected, and they said this is objectionable. So the grounds are that, so they are talking in terms of hate speech and regulations for hate speech, how to curb hate speech, and how to encourage free speech. So that is the argument. In that line, they said this particular provision and also two other provisions in the revised Act of 2015, they said these are very broad, these are kind of very vague, and these are liable to be misused, liable to be used by the state and other agencies, and particularly these communities to punish people, to silence people, and so on and so forth. So So in fact, the argument is also based on the global norms of human rights and global understanding of hate speech. So in fact, this is termed as a part of hate speech in a way. But so the argument of HRW is in terms of, with a specific example. So the example is also interesting because the example of the case of Ashish Nandi. So you remember that in Jaipur festival, Ashish Nandi made this comment about the SSTs are the most corrupt people and so on, and later he clarified and apologized, and then court cases and so on. So that is the particular case they refer to, because that is the act under which I think Nandi was charged, because it's a celebrity case. So both the PEN in Canada took it up and they documented in their report, and the HRW directly takes that example and tries to say that if this is how people are silenced, if Nandi is silenced, and Nandi kind of people are silenced, so this act is an act which is problematic. But they have also this argument that that this distinction between humiliating speech and hate speech. So while saying that it is, it doesn't come under hate speech, but they are also saying that it is true that it's humiliating speech. It is what they call negative remarks. So there are certain negative remarks that lead to negative feelings and all that, but those feelings should not be criminalized, should not be made punishable, should not be brought under hate speech provisions, and so on. And in fact, they went on to the extent of saying that there are hate speech laws in India, so there is no need for this particular kind of a provision, and so on and so forth. And they refer to what is called this International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, Article 20, saying that according to that, so this is violative of that Article 20 of ICCPR. So ICCPR, so ICCPR's 22 says this: any advocacy of national, racial, or religious hatred that constitutes incitement to discrimination, hostility, or violence shall be prohibited by law. So this is the plain reading of that. But the interpretation of that is that any remark or any comment should lead to direct violence, direct incitement, and so it should translate into some kind of action. Unless that is translated, you cannot proscribe it. So in a way, that the SST Act, that provision is humiliating. It is humiliating, but it is not leading to any direct violence. So therefore, this should not be invoked, and this has to be amended and all that. So that is the argument. But whereas if you look at the UN, so UN is not aware of the caste context, the Dalit context, the context of casteist speech. So UN is not aware. It's only talking about national, racial, or religious hatred, and so on and so forth. There's no direct reference to this, but and that they directly kind of apply. Yeah, the other two provisions are these. In the new act, these numbers are changed. So that 10 becomes U, V, 10 becomes R, and then there are U and V. And you very well know that U and V also refer to desecrating Ambedkar, garlanding with chapels, or abuses, or any, in fact, the Ambedkar cotton controversy. So those kinds of examples. In fact, in the revised act, the Dalit activists and other campaigners made an attempt to see what are the different kinds of crimes. In fact, the act also, when it comes to parliament, there is an attempt to document the different forms of the violations of rights of these communities. So these are all added. So these two sections, they say that these will lead to curbing of free speech. Supposing somebody criticizes Ambedkar, somebody says something, then they are liable to be punished. So those have to be either amended or deleted and so on. So I don't know, it may be liable. The BJP government might just use it on all the leftists saying that you are insulting Ambedkar. They could very well use it. The misuse is there. But the argument of the activists is that to curb misuse, you have institutions, you have to have prosecution systems, you have courts. For example, if you take up the Nandi's case, So Supreme Court has protected his right. Supreme Court has protected, and he was not even arrested in that particular kind of a case. So there are other kinds of systems to take that, but, and also, yeah, so this is the other example. So the argument is that the free, larger kind of a point is that this kind of a liberal notion of free speech is something that the Dalit activists always confronted in various kinds of occasions, in the Ambedkar cartoon controversy or several other examples. So the free speech and then this violence and violent acts is the attempt. So in a way, if you look at caste abuse, caste slur, caste hatred, caste superiority, caste pride, caste arrogance, these all will be coming under free speech, because nothing will directly lead to any violence. You can be arrogant, you can be superior, you can say something to somebody, or you can say that I will not sit beside you, I will sit somewhere else, I will not talk to you, and so on. So there are many ways in which the caste operates in this kind of a society, and there are many language forms it takes, many, many silent kind of forms it takes, but so all that will come under a humiliating speech, but it is also a free speech. So this is the problem that I found with that particular kind of argument, and the particular kind of argument doesn't take into consideration the specificity, historicity, and the context of this act, and the kind of issues that are documented, and so on and so forth. And in fact, the phenomena of mass killings in the 1980s, the Karan Chedu in 1985, out of which this act was a product of that debate, and also this particular act was an advance from the earlier civil rights, earlier disabilities debate to violations of human dignity, and so on and so forth. And in fact, if you look at some examples, since I don't have much time, another 2-3 minutes. So you have, you take concrete examples of a Dalit flogging incident in Una, Gujarat, or there is a very well-known case in Andhra Pradesh where the torturing of two Dalit youth by an MLA, which is going on for 20 years without any punishment, and so on. And so these are examples where distinction between speech and violence is very difficult to make in the context of Dalit context. So in fact, either the speech or the abuse follows violence, or sometimes you are beating up in the Una case, and also you are abusing. So this distinction between the speech, whether the another context, in the context of the US, Judith Butler has this whole argument about the injury of speech in the context of the blacks, burning of a cross, and so on, and how it posed a challenge to the freedom of speech, the First Amendment in the US. So obviously the words definitely would wound, it causes wound. And how does one think of that? So this whole speech and the physical is something that you cannot really separate. And since I have another 2 minutes, and in fact, even the other one, when you talk about the Ambedkar, the Ramabai killings in Mumbai, if you look at the report on that particular incident, it is very, very clear that the whole thing starts by provoking, by garlanding with chapels, the Ambedkar statue. Many times this, so it looks like it's a separately, it is like insulting Ambedkar only. So insulting Ambedkar is not something that will lead to anything, but obviously in the Indian case, it leads to definitely violence and killing of people. So this is very difficult to make this kind of a distinction between this the words and the words leading to action, and so on. In the last part, I just want to bring to your attention Ambedkar's own comment in relation to this. In the Constitution Assembly debate, itself, this issue came up in terms of what is violence and what is speech, what is violence, what is not violence. I'll just read this. Since I've started 1 minute late, I'll take this 1 minute and read this and conclude this. I come now to specific instances. This is Ambedkar speaking. Supposing, for instance, there is trouble. I'm giving some concrete cases which have happened. And there is trouble between the scheduled caste and caste Hindus in a particular village. And the caste Hindus conspire together to proclaim a social boycott on the scheduled caste, preventing them from obtaining any kind of supplies, preventing them from going into the fields, preventing them from going into the jungles to collect fuel. Then I want to know from Dr. Shyam Prasad Mukherjee and Pandit Kunjru whether they want this as an offense to be regarded by the state as such or not. And similarly, about drawing water from a village as well, and if you poison it, whether it is violence, whether this can be offense or not. So I think with that, I'll stop. Thank you.
To being here, to present, for me, it's a new experiment. New experiment with words and concepts in the part of movements in Telugu states. As a short story writer, I'm feeling like story of the words. I am comfortable with Telugu, please. Telugu states law, okay, historical movement after independent anukunnappudu, Ongolu jillalo karam chedu Kammabu swamula cheta aaruguru madigalu champapaddaru. Aithe aa sanghatanaku vyatirekanga ఒక హిస్టారిక్ మూమెంట్ జరిగింది. అది అంతకుముందు చాలా మూమెంట్స్ ఉన్నాయి. ఏంటంటే మీకు అందరికి తెలుసు, యాంటీ క్లాస్ మూమెంట్స్ ఉన్నాయి. అయితే దాన్ని కూడా యాంటీ క్లాస్ మూమెంట్లో భాగంగా చూస్తూ ఒక దాన్ని రుజువు చేయడం. ఇదేంటంటే, ఇవి క్యాస్ట్ కిల్లింగ్స్. కమ్మ భూస్వాములతో మాదిగలు చంపబడ్డారు అనేది అది ఒక ప్రూవ్ చేయడం. ఆ మూమెంట్లో ఒక ఆ ఉద్యమానికి నాయకత్వం వహించిన నాయకులు కూడా, ఇది జస్ట్ వర్గ సమస్య కాదు, ఇది కుల సమస్య. వాళ్ళు కమ్మలు జస్ట్ భూస్వాములు కాదు, వాళ్ళు కమ్మ డామినెంట్ కాస్ట్ అనేది. అది ఒక ప్రూవ్ చేసే పరిస్థితులలో చాలా షిఫ్ట్, చాలా చేంజెస్ జరిగినాయి. ఈవెన్ కాన్సెప్ట్ పరంగా పర్సెప్షన్స్, వ్యూస్ అన్నీ కూడా జరిగినాయి. అక్కడే మొట్టమొదట దళిత్ అనే పదాన్ని నేను ఫస్ట్ విన్నాను. దళిత్ పదంతో దళిత మహాసభ ఎమర్జ్ అయ్యింది. అయితే అక్కడ ఆ సంఘటనను అందరూ వ్యతిరేకించారు. అంతకుముందు ఉన్న కమ్యూనిస్టుల పనిచేసే దళితులు, కమ్యూనిస్టులో లేని దళితులు, క్రిస్టియన్ దళిత్స్ అందరూ ఆ సంఘటనను ఊచకోతని వ్యతిరేకిస్తూ పెద్ద ఉద్యమం జరిగింది. అయితే అక్కడ టర్ము అంతకుముందు హరిజన్ టర్మ్ వాడబడింది. హరిజన్ టర్మ్ అంటే అది మెయిన్ స్ట్రీమ్ టర్మ్, పుస్తక భాష, శానిటైజ్డ్ భాష, సంస్కృటైజ్డ్ భాష, మెయిన్ స్ట్రీమ్ భాష, గ్రంథ భాష, అరిజన్ అనేది. ఇంకొకటి, అదే హరిజన్కి వాడుక భాషలో మాదిగ, మాల, యానాది ఇట్లా అన్నట్టు. అదే టర్మ్ని ఇదేమో గ్రామాలలో యూజ్ చేస్తారు. గ్రామాలలో పలానా వాళ్ళు ఎవరంటే మాదిగ, పలానా వాళ్ళు ఎవరంటే మాల, ఇట్లా ఉంది. అదే మాదిగ మాల ఒక మండల ఆఫీస్కి వెళ్తేనో, ఒక ప్రొఫెసర్ దగ్గరికి వెళ్తానో, ఒక లీడర్ దగ్గరికి వెళ్తానో, నేను హరిజన్. అంటే విలేజ్లో మాదిగ అనే పదము మెయిన్ స్ట్రీమ్లోకి చాలా అవసరాలు ఉంటాయి కదా. కాస్ట్ సర్టిఫికెట్ కావాలి, పిల్లోడికి అడ్మిషన్ కావాలి, ఇంకా పలానా స్కీమ్ కింద ఇల్లు కావాలి, అట్లా అన్నప్పుడు హరిజన్. ఎందుకంటే దే ఆర్ ఎంకరేజింగ్ హరిజన్ వర్డ్స్. ఇప్పటికి కూడా హరిజన్ వర్డ్ గ్రామాలలో చాలామంది వాడుతున్నారు. ఇది జస్ట్ యాక్సిడెంటల్ వర్డ్ కాదని నా అభిప్రాయం. ఎందుకంటే హరిజన్ అనేది డిగ్రేడింగ్ దళిత్స్ అని చాలా ఇప్పటికే దాని మీద చర్చ జరిగింది, అసెంబ్లీ వరకు కూడా జరిగింది. అసెంబ్లీలో ముందు పార్లమెంట్లో దాన్ని ప్రొహిబిట్ చేశారు. అసెంబ్లీలో కూడా హరిజన్ అని పిలవద్దని మహిళా ఎమ్మెల్యేలు దాని మీద చాలా ఆర్గ్యూ చేశారు. ఒక లాజిక్ ఏంటంటే హరిజన్ అని చాలా మంచి వర్డ్ కదా, హరికి పుట్టిన వాళ్ళు హరిజనులు, మీరెందుకు డిగ్రేడ్గా ఫీల్ అవుతున్నారు అని మళ్ళీ వాళ్ళే ఎవరైతే యూజ్ చేస్తున్నారో వాళ్ళు యూజ్ చేసేది దాన్ని జస్టిఫై చేసుకోవడము. ద సేమ్ టైం వాళ్ళు ఎంత సాఫ్ట్ గొంతుతో ఎంత ప్రేమతో చెప్పినా అది మాలమాదిగలకి అనుమానం అన్నమాట. ఎంత సాఫ్ట్గా చెప్పినా ఒక అనుమానం, మమ్మల్ని తగ్గిస్తున్నారు. మరి మమ్మల్ని ఎందుకు హరిజనులు అంటున్నారు? మీరు కూడా హరిజనులే కదా. దేవుడి బిడ్డలు అనుకోవడానికి మీకెందుకు ప్రాబ్లము? దేవుడి బిడ్డలు అంటే కరెక్ట్ అంటే మీకెందుకు ప్రాబ్లం? మీకు కూడా మంచి కదా. మరి ఇంకా చాలా హిందూ దేవుళ్ళని మొక్కుతారు, మరి హిందూ దేవుళ్ళ బిడ్డలంటే ప్రాబ్లం ఏంటి అనేది ఒక డౌట్ ఎప్పుడు అనుమానంతో దాన్ని కాదు ఇక్కడ ఇది కాదు ఇది కాదు. మొత్తానికైతే ఈ దళితుల నుండి వేరు చేయడానికి ఒక వర్డ్ ఎప్పుడు మెయిన్ స్ట్రీమ్ మైండ్ సెట్, మెయిన్ స్ట్రీమ్ బ్రాహ్మణికల్ మైండ్ సెట్ వర్డ్స్నంతా కూడా ఎప్పుడు ఇంపోజ్ చేస్తూ ఉంది దళితుల మీద. అట్లాంటిది హరిజన్. దాన్ని అబ్జెక్ట్ చేసేది ఒక చైతన్య స్థాయి. అది మూమెంట్స్లో భాగంగా వచ్చింది. ఆ హరిజన్ ప్లేస్లో, కారంచేడు మూమెంట్లో హరిజన్ ప్లేస్లో ఫస్ట్ దళిత్ అనే వర్డ్ వచ్చింది. ఎట్లా అంటే ఇద్దరు లెజెండ్స్ ఉన్నారు ఏపీలో, ఒకరు కత్తి పద్మారావు, ఒకరు గద్దర్. గద్దర్ మార్క్సిస్ట్ రైటర్, కత్తి పద్మారావు దళిత మహాసభ ఫౌండర్. వాళ్ళిద్దరి మధ్య అంతకుముందు సంబంధాలు లేవు. ఆ కారంచేడు మూమెంట్లో వాళ్ళిద్దరూ ఒక కాన్వర్జేషన్లో గద్దర్ ఒక పాట రాస్తాడు కారంచేడు మీద. ఏంటంటే కూలీ పులులమ్మ, కూలీ అంటే లేబర్, పులి అంటే టైగర్. కూలీ పులులమ్మ కారంచెడు భూస్వాములతోని కలబడి నిలబడి పోరు చేసిన కూలీ పులులమ్మ అనే ఒక పాట చాలా ఫేమస్. అది ఒక రకంగా అక్కడున్న మాదిగలని మాలలని చాలా ఇన్స్పైర్ చేసి మూమెంట్లో కదిలించిన పాట. అయితే ఇంకా కూలీ ఏంటి, కూలీ ప్లేస్లో దళిత్ పెట్ట అని చెప్పి కత్తి పద్మారావు ఆ వర్డ్ని మార్చేపించిండ్రు అన్నట్టు. దళిత్ అని అంటే ఒక మార్క్సిస్ట్ పర్సెప్షన్ నుండి ఒక కొత్త పర్సెప్షన్. దళిత్ అనేది కొత్త పర్సెప్షన్. దాంతో కొంత కంఫర్ట్గా ఫీల్ అయ్యిండ్రు. హరిజన్ అనేది డిస్కంఫర్ట్. కూలీ అనేది జస్ట్ లేబర్ అని చంపలేదు వాళ్ళు. ఈ మాదిగా వీళ్ళు ఎస్సీలని, వీళ్ళు తక్కువ అని, వీళ్ళు ఎప్పుడు కూడా మాకు ఎదురు తిరిగి మాట్లాడకూడదు, వీళ్ళని శాశ్వతంగా అణిచిపెట్టాలి అనే దాంతో వాళ్ళు చేస్తున్నప్పుడు ఇంకా కూలీ ఏంటి అని ఒక మార్క్సిస్ట్ దృక్కోణం నుండి ఒక కొత్త దళిత దృక్కోణంలోకి ఫస్ట్ టైం ఆ పాట ద్వారా వచ్చింది. ఒక మార్క్సిస్ట్ దళిత్, ఒక నాన్ మార్క్సిస్ట్ దళిత్. అంబేద్కర్ అయిట అని చెప్పలేము అప్పుడు. అంబేద్కర్ను అప్పుడు మళ్ళీ అంబేద్కర్ చాలా అప్పుడు చాలా ఒక స్ట్రెంగ్తెన్ చేయడానికి వచ్చింది. ఎందుకంటే ఆ మూమెంటు జస్ట్ ఆ ఊచపోత వల్ల వచ్చిన మూమెంటు. అంబేద్కర్ను స్టడీ చేసి ఆత్మగౌరవ పోరాటం చెయ్యాలి అని ప్రొయాక్టివ్ మూమెంట్ కాదు. కాబట్టి అప్పుడు దళిత్ అనే పదం అట్లా వచ్చింది. దళిత్స్ చాలామందికి అది కంఫర్ట్ వచ్చింది, ఒక న్యూ స్ట్రెంగ్త్ ఎనర్జీ ఇచ్చిన వర్డ్ అది. దాని తర్వాత కూడా మార్క్సిస్ట్లో ఉన్న దళితులు వాళ్ళ పాటల్ని చేంజ్ చేసిండ్రు. అంతకుముందు ఉందర్రా కూలిపేట ఆ ఊరి చివర కాస్టాలున్న చోట అన్నప్పుడు కూలిపేట అంటే అక్కడ బ్రాహ్మణ్ పేద కూలి కూడా ఉండొచ్చు, కానీ కాస్టాలు ఉండవు. కాస్టాల్ అంటే బరియల్ గ్రౌండ్స్. కానీ ఈ చైతన్యం తర్వాత ఉందర్రా మాలపేట ఆ ఊరి చివర కాస్టాలున్న చోట అంటే మాలలు కాస్టాలు ఉన్న దగ్గర ఉంటారు. ఇంకా మాదిగలను కూడా యాడ్ చేయడం కోసం కష్టాలు, చాలా కష్టాలు ఉన్న దగ్గర మాదిగపేట ఉంటుంది, కాస్టాలు ఉన్న దగ్గర మాలపేట ఉంటుంది. ఇది ఒక ఫస్ట్ టైం జనరలైజ్ చేయకుండా క్లాస్ పర్సెప్షన్ నుండి వచ్చిన షిఫ్ట్ ఇది కారం చెడు మూమెంట్తో. ఇంకా దాని తర్వాత ఆ మూమెంట్ చాలా స్టెప్ బై స్టెప్ చాలా మలుపులు తీసుకుంది. మా దగ్గర అప్పుడు ఎన్టీ రామారావు ముఖ్యమంత్రిగా ఉన్నారు, హోమ్ మినిస్టరు అంటే కమ్మ పవర్ ఉంది, హోమ్ మినిస్టర్ కమ్మ చీఫ్ మినిస్టర్ కమ్మ మాదిగల మీద దాడి జరిగింది. ఇంకా తర్వాత కొన్ని రోజులకి చుండూరు హోమ్ మినిస్టర్ రెడ్డి చీఫ్ మినిస్టర్ రెడ్డి చుండూరు దళితుల చుండూరు మాలల మీద అదే ప్లాన్డ్గా అదే వాళ్ళ చైతన్యాన్ని ఓర్చుకోలేనకుండా మనం చెప్పలేనంత రూడుగా ఆ ఊచకోత జరిగింది. అక్కడ కారంచెడు నుండి చుండూరు వరకు ఒక క్లారిటీ తెచ్చుకున్న మూమెంట్ సేమ్ దళిత మహాసభ. కారంచెడులో ఎక్కడెక్కడైతే ఏమేమి చిన్న చిన్న పొరపాట్లు జరిగినాయో అట్లాంటి అన్ని పొరపాట్లు జరగకుండా చుండూరులో చేయడము, అక్కడ దళిత్ అనేది విపరీతంగా మళ్ళీ సెల్ఫ్ రెస్పెక్ట్ కూడా అంటే అప్పుడు ఒక దళిత్కు డెఫినేషన్ కూడా వెతుక్కున్నప్పుడు హరిజన్ కంటే బెటర్ ఉంది. హరిజన్ అంటే మళ్ళీ వీళ్ళు ఎందుకు ఎంకరేజ్ చేస్తున్నారంటే ఒక కుల అణచివేత ఏదైతుందో కులము అని అంటే కులంని మళ్ళీ జనరలైజ్ చేయడం టర్మ్ కులము అని అంటే ఒక ఒక వైపు కులం అంటే ఒక కత్తి లాంటిది అయితే ఒక ఎడ్జ్ దళితులను ఎప్పుడు సప్రెస్ చేస్తుంటుంది, ఇంకొక ఎడ్జ్ ఆధిపత్య కులాలను ఎప్పుడు సుపీరియర్గా నిలబెడుతుంటుంది. కులం అంటే వీళ్ళ కులం వీళ్ళ ముక్కులం ఒకటి కాదు. మాలల గురించి మాట్లాడేటప్పుడు అదే టోన్ మాట్లాడతాము. జనరల్గా ఒక కమ్మ బ్రాహ్మణ్ వెలమ రెడ్డి వాళ్ళ ఆరగెంట్ గురించి మాట్లాడేటప్పుడు కూడా కులం 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 అని మాట్లాడు, ముఖ్యంగా అకాడమిక్స్లో జరుగుతూ ఉంటుంది ఇది. ఇంకా అదేంటంటే ఒక అందులో ఉన్న రూడు స్లేవరీ ఒక బానిసత్వాన్ని ఎప్పుడు హైడ్ చేసే ప్రయత్నం ఈ వర్డ్స్లల్లో బాగా ఉంటుంది. అప్పుడు హరిజన్ అంటే దేవుని బిడ్డలు, దేవుడేంటి దేవుడి బిడ్డలు, ఇది మేము దేవుడి బిడ్డలు కాదు, మీలాగా మీకు తాత ఉన్నాడు మీకు తండ్రి ఉన్నాడు, మాకు కూడా తాత తండ్రి ఉన్నారు, మా ఫోర్ ఫాదర్స్ ఉన్నారు, వాళ్ళ పేర్లన్నీ మాకు తెలుసు, మా తండ్రి బిడ్డల మేము దేవుని బిడ్డలం కాదు అని ఒక రిజెక్షన్ అనేది హరిజన్ అనే పదానికి సీరియస్గా వచ్చింది. అప్పుడు మరి దళిత్ అంటే ఏంటి అనుకున్నప్పుడు దళిత్ అంటే ఒక సప్రెషన్ని ఇండికేట్ చేస్తుంది, ఒక బ్రేక్ ఫ్రమ్ విలేజ్. దళితులు విలేజ్ నుండి బ్రేక్ అయిన ఒక వాడ, వెలివాడ, దళిత వాడ. ఓకే, ఇది సప్రెషన్ ఉంది, ఎక్స్క్లూజన్ ఉంది, ఈ మేరకు క్యాస్ట్ డిస్క్రిమినేషన్ని, క్యాస్ట్ హైరార్కీని, క్యాస్ట్ ఎక్స్క్లూషన్ దాన్ని కాస్త ఐడెంటిఫై చేసుకొని మేమంతా నిలబడవచ్చు అని చెప్పి నిజంగా ఒక పవర్ఫుల్గా వచ్చింది. రెండు స్టేట్స్లలో కూడా ఆ వర్డ్తోనే కాస్త ఎన్జిఓలు కూడా బాగా పనిచేసినాయి. హ్యూమన్ రైట్స్ వాచ్ కూడా అసలు దళితులను కోర్టుకి ఎట్లా వెళ్ళొచ్చు, సప్రెషన్ని ఎట్లా ఆర్టికులేట్ చేయాలి, సప్రెషన్ ఫామ్స్ ఏంటి, ఎట్లా పోలీస్ స్టేషన్కి వెళ్ళాలి, ఇవన్నీ కూడా ఒక వర్క్ చేసి పెట్టిన దాంట్లో దళిత్ అనే దాని కిందనే ఎక్కువ జరిగింది. ఇంకా వస్తున్న చైతన్యంలో दानु कासट्टी उटांगा गुड़ा तीसुकुन्नारु इकड़ हरिजन अने पदाल पदान्नि डीकोड चेयडम गुड़ा दान्नि रिजेक्ट चेयडम एप्पुडु अंटे डीकोड चेयगलिगिनप्पुडे दान्नि रिजेक्ट चेशारु एप्पुडु इंकोकटि తర్వాత ఎదుగుతున్న క్రమంలో దళిత్ చాలామంది ఫస్ట్ జనరేషన్ చదువుకుంటా ఉన్నారు, ఇంగ్లీష్ చదువుకుంటా ఉన్నారు. వాళ్ళకి కావాల్సిన ప్రొఫెషన్లోకి వెళ్ళాలనే ఒక థాట్. విలేజ్లో ప్రొఫెషన్ అంటే దళితులకు సంబంధం లేదు. దళిత్ ప్రొఫెషన్ ఏంటంటే జీతగాడు, పెద్ద జీతగాడు, చిన్న జీతగాడు, పెద్ద జీతగాడు, చిన్న జీతగాడు, అదే ప్రొఫెషన్. కానీ ఈ ఉద్యమాల చైతన్యం వల్ల ఏమున్నాయి అవకాశాలు అన్నంటే, రిజర్వేషన్ ఉన్న సంగతి కూడా తెలియని పరిస్థితుల్లో నుండి రిజర్వేషన్ ఉంది. దానివల్ల మనం వెళ్ళాలి, అక్కడ వెళ్ళి చదువుకోవాలి. విలేజ్లో ఉంటే చదువుకోవడానికి ఉండదు కాబట్టి సిటీకి వెళ్ళాలి. అక్కడ ఉండి చదువుకుంటే మన కులం ఏందో తెలియదు, రిజర్వేషన్ వాడుకోవచ్చు అనే ఒక సీరియస్ డ్రీమ్స్ ఒకటి దళిత్స్లల్లో రావడము. అట్లా వచ్చిన ఇప్పటి వరకు వచ్చిన చైతన్యం దళిత్ అంటే కూడా ఎస్సీ ఎస్టీలకి, ఎస్సీ ఎస్టీలు అంటే మళ్ళీ ఒక గవర్నమెంట్ డాక్యుమెంట్ టర్మ్, అది పొలిటికల్ టర్మ్ కాదు. దళిత్ అంటే ఒక పొలిటికల్ క్లెయిమింగ్ టర్మ్. అది మళ్ళీ ఒక సెక్షన్ ఆఫ్ ఎడ్యుకేటెడ్ పీపుల్కు దళిత్ అంటే అర్థమవుతుంది. మళ్ళీ మెజారిటీ గ్రామాలలో ఉన్న వాళ్ళకి దళిత్ అంటే అర్థం కాదు. నువ్వెవరు అనంటే నేను ఎస్సీ. ఎస్సీ అనంటే మండల ఆఫీస్కి పోయినప్పుడు ఎస్సీ అంటాడు. నేను మాదిగ, నేను మాల, నేను చిందు, నేను డక్కలి, నేను బేగరి, ఈ రకంగా వాళ్ళ లాంగ్వేజ్ ఉంది. దానివల్ల వాళ్ళు ఎప్పుడు మేము తక్కువనే ఫీలింగ్ లేదు. ఇంకా అది వస్తున్నప్పుడు ఇంట్రెస్టింగ్ ఏంటంటే, ఇప్పుడు దళిత్ అనే టర్మ్ కూడా లిమిటెడ్ అయిపోయింది. దళిత్ అంటే ఒక బ్రేక్ను ఒకదాన్ని చూపిస్తుంది, డిస్క్రిమినేషన్ని చూపిస్తుంది. కానీ ఈ స్ట్రగుల్స్ని, యాంటీకాస్ట్ స్ట్రగుల్ ఏవైతున్నాయో, ఈ స్ట్రగుల్స్కు చాలా కోణాలు ఉన్నాయి. ఇంకా చాలా వ్యూస్, చాలా డైమెన్షన్స్ ఉన్నాయి. దీనికి ఒక సెల్ఫ్ రెస్పెక్ట్ ఉంది, దీనికి ఒక విజన్ ఉంది, దీనికి ఒక ఈస్థెటిక్స్ ఉంది, దీనికి ఒక చరిత్ర ఉంది అని ఇన్ని కోణాలు చూసినప్పుడు దళిత్ అనేది లిమిట్ అవుతుంది. కాబట్టి దానికి సరిపడే టర్మ్ ఏది అనుకొని చూసుకున్నప్పుడు, ఎవరికి వాళ్ళు కంఫర్ట్గా వాళ్ళకున్న ఎగ్జిస్టెడ్ కమ్యూనిటీ పేరు ఏది అవుతుందో దాన్ని చెప్తూనే, మరి మనం అందరము యూనిటీ కావాలి, క్యాస్ట్ డిస్క్రిమినేషను అన్ని కులాలని విభజిస్తుంది, ఇది అన్ని కులాలని దేనికక్కడ విభజిస్తుంది. కాబట్టి క్యాస్ట్ బెనిఫిషియర్స్ అండ్ విక్టిమ్స్, క్యాస్ట్ విక్టిమ్స్ ఎవరెవరు ఉన్నారు అనుకున్నప్పుడు పోలరైజేషన్ అనేది వాళ్ళ మైండ్లో. పోలరైజేషన్ ఎక్కడ జరుగుతుందంటే క్యాస్ట్ విక్టిమ్స్, ఎవరు మళ్ళీ ఎస్సీ ఎస్టీ బీసీ వీళ్ళందరూ కూడా క్యాస్ట్ విక్టిమ్స్ అనే ఒక బ్రాడ్ ఆలోచన, బ్రాడ్ చైతన్యము ఇప్పుడు వచ్చింది. మరి వీళ్ళందరం కూడా కలవడానికి ఏ టర్మ్ కంఫర్ట్ అన్నప్పుడు, ఇప్పుడు చాలామంది బహుజన, బహుజన హితాయ, బహుజన సుఖాయ, ఇది బహుజనులను అందరినీ కూడా నా మాదిగా ఐడెంటిటీని నేను సెల్ఫ్ రెస్పెక్ట్గా చెప్తూనే, బహుజన అనే దాంట్లో మిగతా వాళ్ళతో నేను కలిసే ఒక వేదిక ఉంటుంది అనేది. ఇప్పుడు మాదిగా అనేది ఒక సఫిక్స్ ఏర్పడడం, దానికి ఒక 25 సంవత్సరాల మూమెంట్. మాదిగ అంటే డిగ్రేడ్, హరిజన్ ఎంతనో మాదిగానా అనేదంతా దళితులు కూడా ఆలోచించిన దానికి. మాదిగ అంటే మనం పుట్టింది, హరిజన్ అనేది అవతల నుండి ఇంపోజ్ చేయబడ్డది. కాబట్టి మాదిగ అనేదానికి మనం ఎక్కడ సిగ్గుపడొద్దు, మాదిగ చెప్పుకోవడానికి సిగ్గుపడొద్దని ఎంఆర్పిఎస్ మాదిగ రిజర్వేషన్ పోరాట సమితి దాదాపు 1994 నుండి 1994 ఏర్పడి ఇప్పటి వరకు పోరాటం చేస్తూ ఉంది. ఆ పోరాట చైతన్యంతో, ఆ సంస్కృతితో, ఆ పేరును వెనకాల సమ్ రెడ్డి, సమ్ చౌదరి లాగా, మందకృష్ణ మాదిగ, ఇంకా మేరీ మాదిగ, జీవా మాదిగ, इत्ला आ मादिगल अंदर गुड़ा तम पेर पक्की पेट्टुकुन्ना ओकटी इदुंदी इदु गुड़ा ओका पर्सेप्शन नु वाला कंफर्ट नु वाला मीद इंपोज चेसे वर्ड्स नी वर्ड नी रिजेक्ट रिजेक्ट चेयडम इदी ఈ పోరాటంలో భాగమని నేను అనుకుంటున్నా. ముఖ్యంగా ఈ వర్డ్స్ని యూజ్ చేయడం అనేది ఒక మైండ్ సెట్ ప్రాబ్లం, మైండ్ సెట్ అనేది నేను అనుకుంటున్నా. ఇది జస్ట్ డాక్యుమెంట్స్, పాలిటిక్స్, గ్రంథాలు, పుస్తకాలే కాకుండా మైండ్ సెట్ ఇది ఇన్ఫార్మల్గా ఎక్కువ జరుగుతుంటుంది. ఇప్పుడు ఇన్ఫార్మల్గా జరిగేదాన్ని కూడా ఎవిడెన్స్గా చూపడం అనేది ఎస్సీ ఎస్టీ అట్రాసిటీస్ యాక్ట్ గురించి డీటెయిల్డ్గా ఇంతవరకు సత్యనారాయణ గారు ఎట్లా చెప్పారో అట్లా ఎవిడెన్స్ను ప్రొడ్యూస్ చేయడం ఎట్లా అనేది ఈ మూమెంట్లో భాగంగా వచ్చింది. ఇక్కడ ఇన్ఫార్మల్గా స్టేజీల మీద నాకెంత ఫ్రెండ్ అయినా, నా ఫ్రెండ్ ఒక డామినెంట్, మళ్ళీ అప్పర్ కాస్ట్ అంటే కూడా అది దానికి పాలిటిక్స్ లేవు. అప్పర్ అప్పర్ ఎట్లా అవుతుంది, నువ్వు అప్పర్ ఎట్లా ఇది అనేది క్వశ్చన్. నువ్వు అప్పర్ ఎట్లా, ఏడికెళ్ళి అప్పర్ ఎందుకు అప్పర్ అన్నప్పుడు అవును అయ్యో ప్రోగ్రెసివ్ ఫ్రెండ్స్ అయితే అవును కాదు ఏంటి మరి అని అంటే వాళ్ళు ఎప్పుడు డామినేట్ చేస్తుంటారు, లేకుంటే దాడులు చేస్తుంటారు, లేకుంటే క్రిమినల్ యాక్ట్ చేస్తుంటారు. క్రిమినల్ క్యాస్ట్స్, డామినెంట్ కాస్ట్స్ ఈ రకంగా అంటే వాళ్ళని తిట్టడం కాదు, ఆ రకంగా చర్చలు జరిగినప్పుడు మీరు ఎట్లా సవరణ, సవరణ అంటే రేస్, ఆర్ యు రేసిస్ట్, రేసిస్ట్ అయితే మిగతా వాళ్ళని ఏం కావాలి, బ్లాక్స్ ఇక్కడున్న వీళ్ళు. ఈ పదాలు కంఫర్ట్ జోన్ని బాగా ఇచ్చేస్తాయి, కానీ ఒక పొలిటికల్ డిస్కషన్ అయినప్పుడు అందరం కలిసే ఒక వేదికని తీసుకురావడం అనేది ఐడియాలజీ, మైండ్ సెట్, ఒకరి మధ్యలో ఒకరికి ఉండే రెస్పెక్ట్. ఎక్కువ మట్టుకైతే మార్క్సిస్ట్ ప్రోగ్రెసివ్ రైటర్స్తో ఇంటలెక్చువల్స్తో దళితులు ఉంటారు కాబట్టి వీళ్ళు ఫస్ట్ ఒక హడుల్లాగా ఫస్ట్ రిసీవ్ చేసుకోరు మా ఏపీ తెలంగాణ స్టేట్స్లో. వీళ్ళు ఎప్పుడు అవతల పిలక ఉన్న బ్రాహ్మిన్ కనపడాడు, కానీ పిలకలేని మార్క్సిస్టు ఎదురు ఒక హడ్డుల్లాగా తయారయ్యి అదే హరిజన్ అని పిలుస్తారు. అది మైండ్ సెట్ ప్రాబ్లం. దీన్ని ఇది ఒక ఛాలెంజ్గా లిటరేచర్లో దాంట్లో దీంట్లో ఉన్నది. ఒకవేళ హరిజన్ అని ఎవరైనా పిలిస్తే వాళ్ళ మీద ఎస్సీ ఎస్టీ కేసు కూడా బుక్ చేయాలి అనే దాని మీద దళితులు చెప్పేటంత స్థాయి ఉంది దీనికి. నిజంగా మీరు ఈ టాపిక్ నాకు చాలా పనిపెట్టింది, దీని మీద ఇంకా పనిచేయాలని నాకు చాలా ఇంట్రెస్ట్ ఉంది. నెక్స్ట్ మీరు పవర్ పాయింట్ చేస్తే కూడా చాలా బాగుండేది, నాకు ఐడియా ఇప్పుడు వస్తుంది, నెక్స్ట్ ఇంకెప్పుడైనా చేస్తాను. థ్యాంక్ యూ సో మచ్ ఫర్ దిస్ వండర్ఫుల్ ఆపర్చునిటీ.
షార్ట్ సమరీ ఆఫ్ హర్ స్పీచ్. సో షీ వాజ్ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ హౌ ఆఫ్టర్ ఇండిపెండెన్స్ కారంచేడు ఇన్సిడెంట్ ఇన్ కారంచేడు దెర్ వాజ్ ఇన్సిడెంట్ ఆఫ్ 6 మాదిగాస్ వర్ కిల్డ్ బై కమ్మాస్ అండ్ దెర్ వాజ్ ఎ హిస్టారికల్ మూమెంట్ టుక్ ప్లేస్ అండ్ షీ సేస్ ఇట్స్ హిస్టారికల్ బికాస్ ఎర్లియర్ ఓన్లీ యాంటీ క్లాస్ మూమెంట్స్ వర్ దేర్, నన్ ఆఫ్ దెమ్ వర్ రియల్లీ యాక్చువల్లీ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ కాస్ట్ అండ్ ఓన్లీ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ క్లాస్. బట్ సో ఇన్ ఆఫ్టర్ దట్ కాస్ట్ క్లిల్లింగ్స్ దిస్ మూమెంట్ హ్యాడ్ టు ప్రూవ్ దట్ దిస్ ఈస్ నాట్ ఎ క్లాస్ స్ట్రగుల్, కాస్ట్ క్లాస్ కిల్లింగ్స్ బట్ మోర్ ఆఫ్ కాస్ట్ మర్డర్. సో బికాస్ దే సెడ్ దట్ killers are not just landlords but are their kammas, they killed not just because they are laborers but because they are madigas. So she says that she came to know that word only then and under the leadership of Kathi Padmarao and Gadar they had this Dalit Mahasabha and so Christian Dalits, communists were opposed this idea of Dalit Mahasabha. So earlier only what the word the Harijan was used. It is a very bookish word which doesn't operate in the daily life. Madigas and Malas were used in a daily language. So in the government offices, Madigas and Malas were identified as Harijans and when they need caste certificate and so on. But Harijan is still used in the villages. But Dalits argued that Harijan is degrading and some of the it was debated in the assembly also. And the Harijan meaning son of Hari, son of gods, and Harijans. These people questioned that why only Dalits are son of gods, you are also son of gods. So let's have a common name. Why should only be Dalits called as Harijans? So they opposed it, saying that you are trying to give a separate identity to discriminate us. Gaddar wrote a song at that time called Kooli Pululamma, saying that it is a laborer tigers kind of thing. But then Kathi Padmarao insisted that we should make it a caste consciousness, that he insisted that he used the word Dalit. He sang a song also, Dalita Pululamma. And so that is when the Dalit word came into existence, and people started using it. Dalits were happy with this word more than Harijan. And Marxist also changed their view and started using. So the Marxist view changed to Dalit, non-Marxist view. She didn't recognize that as Ambedkarite view, but non-Marxist view. Later on, Marxists also used the word Dalit, Madhika, Mala, not just their class words. So in this incident, N.T. Rama Rao was the chief minister. He was Kamma, and the home minister was also Kamma. And this caste killings was against Madhigas. And then later on, there is another incident in Chunduru where they attack on Malas. See, both CM and Home Minister were reddies. So in this moment, Dalit were became they used extensively. So she had compared caste to a sword. Sword, the edge of the sword being the Malas and Madhigas who gets attacked by this sword, and the arrogance of upper caste used as the other end of the sword, and it's used as their arrogance, which is how we generally discuss in the academic circles. So the word, she says that word Dalit signifies oppression and discrimination, and it was helpful for the people to stand together and fight. And Human Rights Watch also helped Dalits to use how to use state mechanisms and all of that. Dalit word became very assertive term for the Dalits, SCs, STs. Mostly because of these revolutions after these caste killings, people got to know that they actually have reservations, and they started migrating to cities. And because in cities you are not visible, your caste identity is not visible. So Dalit word is very political, and he says it's very limited because it only shows oppression and discrimination, but doesn't really show that the sense of self-respect and Dalit aesthetics, culture, any side of that. So caste victims are racist and SCs, and there is polarization happens because of that. Because Dalit word was limited, and this new word came into being, which is the Bahujan identity, which asserts self-respect as a common identity while still sticking to your Madhiga and Mala identity, which doesn't reject their identity. And then Madhiga Reservation Samiti, Madhiga Reservation Samiti, which is MRBS, founded by Krishna Madhiga, who insisted that we use Madhiga, we should assert our Madhiga name, and started using Madhiga, which is not a surname, but he insisted that we should use it as a surname. So he, Manda Krishna Madhiga, and like the people started using this as a surname. And she says that caste identity it's in your conscious, it's your mindset, and it operates in very informal ways. And she questions that how is upper, how did this upper caste become upper? And the upper caste are generally basically criminal caste, and they are dominant caste. She says that calling them criminal caste might make them discomfort, but that's how we should speak. The final comment was very interesting. She said Marxist Brahmins use the word Dalit to degrade them, but not the conservative Brahmins. Yeah, that's it.
On these things for some time, and here we come as not as faculty and students of Azim Premji University, but more so as co-founders of Ambedkar Feminism Study and Struggle Alliance, that is a group in Azim Premji University, and we have a few other members as well of that in the audience. It's also a privilege to be in the same panel as Professor Satyanarayana and Ms. Gogu Shamla. We have drawn heavily on Professor Gopal Guru's and Professor Satyanarayana's work in this paper, so it's good to get his feedback as well from this. I'll start with Pat Parker, black feminist poet. This poem called "For the White Person Who Wants to Know How to Be My Friend." I'll just read the first two lines, and because that's where our theorization starts. The first thing you do is to forget that I'm black. The first thing you do is to forget that I'm black. Second, you must never forget that I'm black. So Pat Parker highlights this as an important tension while engaging with identity politics, which emphasizes the importance of both forgetting and not forgetting her black identity at the same time. Although it is presented as a contradiction, it is actually a very productive tension that opens up a new understanding of explicating the Ambedkarite project of annihilating caste. The question that we are asking here, and we invite your attention and response, how do we speak about caste in order to annihilate it and instead of perpetuating it? We are asking this question because it was one of the most central dilemmas that we have been facing at Ambedkar Feminism Group since its inception 3 years ago. The problem seems to be the goal of becoming a casteless society as quickly as possible seems to itself become an impediment in the actual process of annihilating caste. In this quick fix solution, forgetting caste is mistakenly proposed as a way to annihilate it. And any remembrance of caste is seen as perpetuating it. What we are proposing instead is to critique this false binary between annihilation and perpetuation of caste on opposite ends by claiming that the task of annihilating caste is twofold. Firstly, to forget casteism. Again, I'm drawing on Pat Parker's poem on this. Forget casteism, and secondly, to actively perpetuate anti-casteism. So it's not just by forgetting caste that you will annihilate it, but you have to forget casteism and perpetuate anti-casteism. So it's a twofold, it's not a binary between perpetuation and annihilation. So we are challenging this false alternative between forgetting and perpetuating, and nor is it a binary between speaking about caste on one hand or invoking caste in some ways, and not talking about it at all, as if that will suddenly end the caste question. Instead, what we need to do is both forgetting and perpetuating at the same time, and we need to also realize that it cannot be done in this binary that, okay, if we speak about caste, then it will perpetuate it, and if we don't speak about caste, it will annihilate it, right? So what we are complicating this by using a four-cornered analytical framework, where we will argue that both speaking and non-speaking about caste can be used for perpetuating casteism or annihilating it, depending on how it is being done. We will begin by problematizing the dominant Brahminical narrative that erroneously imagines that the more we speak about caste, the more we will reinforce it. So it's better to simply forget about it. In response to this, Professor Satyanarayana, in one of his articles, poignantly raises the question, will India become a caste society if caste is counted? He underscores the problem with his narrative. With this narrative is that there is no nuance between negative and positive discrimination. So caste-based discrimination and caste-based affirmative action both end up in reinforcing caste according to it. However, the solution according to this narrative is not focused so much on ending caste-based discrimination and violence, but it does focus on ending caste-based reservation, caste-based atrocities act, caste-based census, and identity politics. So all the positive discriminatory part has to be ended, but it's not focusing so much on how the negative discrimination will end. Just by forgetting caste, we will be able to come out of it. That's the narrative. What it tries to do is to create a binary between speaking about caste and being silent about it, and advocates a caste-blind position. Their hope is that if we are blind to this difference based on caste, then we will become free from its trap. And it is only politicians, activists, and intellectuals who keep highlighting caste for their own ulterior motives. One small example of how this strategy failed spectacularly is to look at how Kamala Hassan supported the idea of not having caste and religion column in school admission, which would lead to annihilation of caste for the next generation. However, it was soon discovered that even with this strategy and an intercaste marriage that he had, his daughter Shruti Hassan was still very proud of her Tamil Brahmin identity. Now, this is not very unfamiliar to us in Bangalore, where most defense and academic institutions are hegemonized by Tamrams, as they like to call themselves. At the slightest drop of a hat, they want to slip into the pride of their Tamram identity, even when they are speaking about something as banal as curd rice. Surprisingly, anti-caste intellectuals like Anand Taltumbade also seem to be supporting this problematic narrative when he claims that reservation based on the SC category or identity politics of Mayawati end up in perpetuating casteism. What he's unable to apparently distinguish is that the way caste is used in positive discrimination or identity politics by Dalit movement is to perpetuate anti-casteism. And a blanket ban on assertion of caste is not something desirable. To counter this caste-blind approach, which is affordable primarily to Savarnas, there has been a strong call for highlighting the various ways in which caste gets operated in various social and institutional contexts. So now that I have set up the claim that we are going to make, that annihilation of caste is not about forgetting caste, but forgetting casteism and perpetuating anti-casteism, I will now invite Mansa to explicate how do we actually forget casteism, and then Hemant will speak about how do we perpetuate anti-casteism. Just a small note on our methodology. So this is, we follow a feminist relational methodology of research, which is more a dialogical, that's why all three of us are here. And we generally try to work with this group in a dialogical and a relational kind of a research framework, and not thinking of research also as something that coming from an individual perspective. Okay.
Thank you, Asim. Hello, this is Mansa. So I'm going to talk about how caste can be perpetuated by both talking and not talking. In fact, both talking and not talking can lead to a perpetuation of casteism. Even people with best intentions to annihilate caste will end up in perpetuating caste, depending on their way of talking and way of not talking also. So if we know how caste is being perpetuated, then we know how what are the ways to annihilate it as well. So I'll speak about few ways where this casteism is getting perpetuated. The first one is theorizing casteism as a traditional construction and objective reality. So theorizing caste as these two means is problematic because you know, claiming it as an objective reality, it's not true, right? Because it's a lot ingrained in many of us, but it's constructed as if it's, you know, out there and not in us. So for example, as Asim has mentioned about the example of Kamal Hassan, he tells that not talking about caste can lead to annihilation of caste, but it ignores the reality which is out there. Instead that he's proposing the other way to do it. So due to this way also casteism gets perpetuated. And then the second concept is about victimizing Dalits. So people who talk about their culture and who boast about their culture, while doing that they put other culture in an inferiority complex. So for example, if you take an example of the contrast between two movies, Nayakan and Kala. In Nayakan, the upper caste man is portrayed as a savior who goes to save the Dalits, right? So over there, I mean, it's very clear that it's, you know, victimization of Dalits. For example, there is another example from that movie where Dalit woman gets married to another man, which is portrayed in a way where we have to see it an sympathetic way that Dalit woman is getting, you know, help from that man. But in contrast, from Kala movie, Dalit man is portrayed as a leader emerging from Dalit community itself and expecting all of the community members to be leaders and struggle for their existence. So over here we can see how a savior and a leader are constructed, and what kind of messages both the directors and both the movies are using. Because the symbols used are same, the concept that they are trying to provide are different. So over here we can see what kind of distinction is being made. A live example could be that from my classroom experience itself, few of our Dalits have been pointed out by professors from dominant groups and keep asking us to, you say that, you say this, that kind of pointing out, that kind of victimization also makes us feel oppressive and feel inferior. So that can be also one of ways to perpetuate casteism from their angle. And then the third concept is about Brahminical cultural assertion. So again, as I mentioned earlier, that they do boast about their privileges. For example, the food that we were talking about. So why only certain kind of food and culture has to be, take pride about the other, by doing that, the other cultures are being placed in inferiority complex, and there's not enough choice for other cultures to, not enough chance was given to other cultures to take, pride, respect, to talk about their own culture and the food and the other customs of their own culture, right? Over here also that distinction is being made. So due to this, due to their cultural assertion, they're again making few cultures as inferior. So through this way also, they're again, those people are perpetuating caste. So over here, we can see who have spoken about caste and who, how many ways and how they have spoken about it and what is the consequence of it, which is again perpetuating of their casteism, right? So in order to annihilate caste, we need to forget casteism, which is propagated through the above possible ways. So now I invite Hemant to talk about how to perpetuate anti-casteism. Thank you.
In indirect ways. So caste is seen as an instrument of oppression, discrimination and exclusion, predominantly by Savarna. But Dalit's scholarship has criticized this and refined the identity, which is pride in itself and assertive, very assertive, and rather than only source of exclusion. So the rise of Bahujan Samajwadi Party in Uttar Pradesh and Chamar Rab are examples of for asserting your identity of the self with pride and also claiming their share of power. But some people would argue that this move also refi caste, like Asim was speaking about it, but that kind of approach invites a caste-blind approach. And if annihilation of caste means Dalit Bahujans getting more privileges and the Savarna losing their privileges, and therefore resulting in a equal share of privileges, and if that's what annihilation of caste means, and assertion and BSP Dalit politics sits right into the equation, which is basically trying to give privileges to Dalit Bahujans. In a similar manner, Chamar's assertion under leadership of Chandrasekhar Azad by saying the great Chamar, and in Andhra and Telangana, Madhika struggled for categorization within SC category, as Professor Satyanarayana argues in his Dalit reconfiguration of caste. And the so-called reification of caste happens when Dalit Bahujans assume power, because that is when Savarna's privilege is threatened. And whenever Dalit Bahujan claims their space and they are called castes, they are called of being doing reverse casteism and they're being divisive. And this is a very caste-blind approach, and which would mean that any Savarna can lead the movement, and Dalit Bahujans Dalit Bahujans are still acting as foot soldiers and toys in the hands of Savarna. And like Manasa and Asim were saying, Dalit theorization has been able to challenge the existing Brahminical scholarship, which they look caste as a very objective truth, which exists only in the traditions but doesn't really operate in the current times. And Savarna scholarship parachutes on Dalit lived experiences to theorize caste but never investigate caste operations within their own lives and how or in the Savarna circles. Yes. Like in this paper itself, we are claiming that forgetting caste completely will not aid in Ambedkar project, instead actively perpetuating anti-casteism and forgetting casteism, as Mansa mentioned earlier, is what will annihilate caste. And another example for perpetuating anti-casteism would be constitutional provisions. Also, they also have great potential in annihilate caste, because they protect Dalit Bahujans from inhuman practices and from violence, like anti-untouchability act, prevention of SCST atrocities act, and affirmative action. Of course, gives them more privileges to get to represent themselves in education and employment and political arena. So now I will be talking about how anti-casteism can be perpetuated without talking about it directly. One of the great example can be the movie Kala, written and directed by Paranjit. In this movie, there is no direct speaking about caste, but caste is problematized in terms of symbols. There is very less to argue whether it is a Dalit Bahujan film or not. And so the way caste is spoken about in this movie also contributes caste, because it is challenging the status quo and it is challenging the perception of who a Dalit Bahujan is and what is good and bad. So another example, the last example, would be the work of Dr. R.S. Pravin Kumar, IPS, in the social welfare schools in Telangana. So he launched a movement, silent revolution, called Sveroism, where the Svero identity is rejects the stereotyped identities and calls for an identity which is symbolic to self-respect, dignity, and excellence. And which I think it's an important move, because Dalits have always been stigmatized, saying that they are meritless, and to claim that we are a symbol of excellence is a strategic move. And I argue that this also promotes anti-casteism, because we Dalit Bahujans have been given more privileges. So this also has, my last point is that this movement also has potential to annihilate caste, because of its cultural transformations, and because of its strong social networks, people from other castes within the Bahujans are getting attracted to Sveroism. They also want to be identified as Sveros. So thereby, it's breaking the caste lines within the Dalit Bahujans. So which is a great contribution to annihilation of caste. Yes, thank you.
How we have structured the paper is to first say that this binary of not talking about caste and forgetting caste on one hand, and speaking about caste which leads to perpetuation, is something which we reject. And what we are claiming instead is we need to perpetuate anti-casteism, which will need assertion of caste in a particular way, and also requires a kind of forgetting of caste, forgetting of casteism, which is what Mansa was problematizing, in how casteism gets perpetuated within classroom, within popular culture, within more everyday conversations in some ways. And also the point that there are ways of kind of critiquing or perpetuating anti-casteism without necessarily invoking it, because a lot of times we think the more we highlight caste, the more we are able to address the problem as well. But sometimes there are strategic moves where, instead of directly highlighting it, you use other symbols and change the meaning of those symbols through in a more cultural political way, which is what we will hear in the rest of the day with what Urban Folk Project is doing, what Du Saraswati is doing, and those kind of examples. So thank you.
Panel, it's more like a clarifying, I think, question. You were talking about how by changing symbols sometimes you could perpetuate anti-caste movement, but the example of, I haven't seen the film so I don't know, could you give another example to illustrate what you're saying?
Good morning. This question is for Asim. I found your, it was very fascinating what you presented. So as someone from the media, as a journalist, I'm curious, because if you Google Dalit, you know, you get burn, rapes, killings. So how does a journalist report? Because in some way you're contradicting, right? When we go and report, we're highlighting caste, we're perpetuating it. So can you sort of break it down for me?
Soumya Dechamu from the University of Hyderabad. I would like Shyamala to elaborate on, in fact, I think both their work, Asim's, Satya's and Shyamala's, talk to each other in the way how textualizing caste can be perpetuating caste or can be anti-casteism, and Shyamala's short stories, which are both in Telugu and translated in English, is a very good perhaps illustration of how one can use talking about caste in order to perpetuate anti-casteism. I meer koncham mee short stories lo meer caste ni etla anti-caste ideology framework to rastharani, if you can elaborate, I think that will be really nice.
I'm from Badakku Community College. I heard a poem once you started. It was for the white person who wants to be my friend. So how does it correlate caste, and how do you elaborate it? I just want to know about it.
My name is Shubhankar. I work with People Science Movement. I had a question. So one thing I didn't understand partly what you meant by biology and bringing race and gender and differentiating it with caste. I didn't understand fully. Could you elaborate that a little more? The other thing that I felt is that there is a victim narrative there, and it is, I don't know about others, but it's a contemporary reality of my times, because the largest atrocities that are being perpetuated by the state or by the by the whole structure is towards Dalits and Muslims in India in last 20 years, at least what I have seen. And therefore, every time it's a important thing to tell that what is happening, you know, and that's the upper castes are not, no way they are facing that atrocities towards it. So they are the victims in real terms. However, I also understand the necessity for the, as you said, that changing that victim narrative alone. But my question is that, is it not that always it happened through the collective resistance of the fight against caste? Like, for example, in Kelvan Velmani massacre. So there is a, or what is happening, what happened in Uttar Pradesh when people are fighting against Ranveer Sena, you know. So there was a definite assertion. They had put their bodies on the line, even though there were not, the theorizers were not there to theorize and say that, you know, this is an assertion, quote unquote assertion. But did it not mean that there were no assertion at that time? So what is it that we would achieve in saying that, okay, see, your reporting or your way of saying this is a, you are giving a victim narrative. So there is a possibility, I'm not saying that you were saying that, but there is a possibility that you can debunk that as a victim narrative. On the other hand, there is a possibility also, there is a false sense of realism just saying that assertion, you know, it may not be asserting. The a prior woman perhaps would not have the similar kind of assertiveness as a prior man. So, you know, or another man and a woman, that would also be the question. So I'm a bit confused. You could clearly see that. What would it achieve is the question.
Hi, I'm Santosh Kumar from KAIST University. My question is not a bit of comment from some realities from Bihar. So in Bihar also, I mean, they are caste Dusad, and they and Chamar. And they use this term called surname as Ram, okay. And the other terms that Dusad use, that's a Paswan. The Ram Vilas Paswan comes from that caste. However, the people, community people from that that caste, use it without thinking much, and they have appropriated it as it is. So Ram, which symbolizes again the Ram. So Ram Basti, and their Bastis are called Ram Bastis. So I want Gogo Shamla to say something on this line, because it falls with your analysis of different terms for Harijan in that context. I also wonder if you can talk about the resistance to the term Dalit from Dalit Christians. Right, so is something called religion is coming into picture also. So if you can highlight that part also, that will also help us to understand if there's something called Dalit Muslims, right? And last but not least, Professor Satyanarayana's talk, I was thinking about those cultural terms like linguistic slurs embedded in proverbs, proverbs and the idiomatic expressions, and how the discrimination and the violence, the verbal violence, linguistic violence perpetuated through those slur term can be accounted in your analysis. That's all. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Pankaj Anand from Indian Institute of Management. So my question is from Professor K. Satyanarayan. How do you see the role of institution in case of SC versus SC, means Supreme Court versus Scheduled Caste? So we have seen lots of verdict against the Scheduled Caste communities. How do you see this? Your comment.
నిజానికైతే ఒక ఫ్యామిలీ ఒక విషయంలో బయటికి రావడానికి ఎన్ని అడ్డంకులు ఉంటాయనేది నా స్టోరీస్లో చెప్తున్నాను. అంటే ఒక అమ్మాయిని గ్రామంలో నుండి చదువుకోవడానికి వెళ్ళడానికి, ముఖ్యంగా ఆ అమ్మాయిల పట్ల ఈ ఎస్సీ మాలమారిగా ఫ్యామిలీస్కి ఒక డిఫరెంట్ అప్రోచ్ ఉంటుంది. అబల అనే కాన్సెప్ట్ ఉండదు. అమ్మాయి అంటే చాలా ఎనర్జెటిక్గా, అమ్మాయికి చాలా ఎంకరేజ్మెంట్ ఉంటుంది, చాలా ఇంకా అబ్బాయిలని కాస్త డిస్క్రిమినేట్ చేస్తారు ఫ్యామిలీస్లో. అమ్మాయిలను చాలా ఎంకరేజ్ చేస్తారు, దాంతో అమ్మాయిలు చాలా యాక్టివ్ ఉండరు. అది అప్పర్ కాస్ట్ పీపుల్ వాళ్ళకు నచ్చదు, సారీ అప్పర్ కాస్ట్ కాదు గవర్నమెంట్ వాళ్ళకు నచ్చదు. వాళ్ళు ఏంటంటే గృహిణి కాన్సెప్ట్, గృహిణి అంటే ఇంట్లో నుండి బయటికి వెళ్ళొద్దు, మంచిగా తయారు కావాలి, తల మంచిగా దూకోవాలి, చదవకుండా చీర కట్టుకోవాలి, ఇట్లా భర్తకు అందంగా కనపడాలి, ఈ కాన్సెప్ట్ వాళ్ళు ఉండవు. దాన్ని మొత్తం దళిత్ ఎస్సీఎస్ మాలమాదిగా కుటుంబాలు దాన్ని బ్రేక్ చేస్తాయి. వర్కింగ్ కల్చర్, వీళ్ళు ఆరోగ్యంగా ఉంటారు, బాగా తింటారు, బాగా పనిచేస్తారు, ఎప్పుడు బయట ఉంటారు. దీన్ని ఒక మార్క్సిస్ట్ వేలనే క్లాస్ యాంగిల్లో దీన్ని ఆలోచించద్దు. ఎట్లానంటే అగ్రికల్చర్ నాలెడ్జ్కి ఒక సైంటిస్ట్ కంటే ఎక్కువ ఉంటుంది. అగ్రికల్చరల్ నాలెడ్జ్, గ్రీనరీ, నేచర్, మెడిసినల్ ప్లాంట్ నాలెడ్జ్ ఆఫ్ కల్టివేటెడ్ ల్యాండ్, హౌ కల్టివేట్ ద ల్యాండ్ అనే నాలెడ్జ్ అంటే చాలా నాలెడ్జ్ ఉంటూ ఓవరాల్ నాలెడ్జ్ ఉంటుంది. అది జనరేషన్ టు జనరేషన్ వాళ్ళకు అందుతూ ఉంటుంది. ఇదంతా కూడా ఒక అన్టచబిలిటీ అని అంటే ఈ వ్యక్తులు కనపడాలి అన్నమాట. మా ఆడవాళ్ళేమో ఇళ్ళలో ఉంటారు, ఈ పిల్లలేమో చాలా యాక్టివ్ ఉంటారు అని చెప్పి వాళ్ళ మీద అట్రాసిటీస్ జరుగుతాయి పొలాలలో. అట్లా ఈ అమ్మాయిలు ఒక అట్లాంటి కల్చర్ని ఎప్పుడు ఒక కల్చరల్ బ్యాటిల్ అన్నమాట, కల్చరల్ బ్యాటిల్. ఇంకా దళిత్స్ మెయిన్ స్ట్రీమ్లోకి ఎట్లా రావాలి, ఒక కాంపిటీషన్ ఉంటుంది. మా ఏళ్ళైతే ఒక దొర కూతురుకు ఎట్లాంటి ప్రాక్ తీసుకొస్తారో, ఒక మాదిరి అయిన కూడా తన కూతురుకి అట్లాంటి ఫ్రాక్ తీసుకొచ్చేస్తే అది ఒక ప్రాక్. ఆ ఫ్రాక్ వేసినందుకు వాళ్ళు ఆ విలేజ్లోకి పడకడానికి రానివ్వరు. ఒక ఈవెంట్ ఉంటుంది దసరా పండుగకి, అందరూ అక్కడికి వెళ్ళాలి. దొర కూతురు ప్లస్ మాది ఆయన కూతురు సేమ్ ఫ్రాక్తో కనపడవు, అక్కడ కనపడకుండా ఏం చేయాలి, అటాక్స్తారు. ఈ చిన్న చిన్నది ఫ్రాక్ వేసుకోవడం జస్ట్ సెలబ్రేషన్, అది వాళ్ళ డామినేషన్ ఎక్కడ డిస్టర్బ్ చేయదు కానీ వాళ్ళు అది డిస్టర్బ్ అని ఈక్వల్ ఎక్కడ ఉండకూడదు. ఇలా మేము ఎప్పుడు మాకు మేము తక్కువ అనే ఫీలింగ్ ఉండదు. ఎప్పుడు దొర ఎంత దొంగనో తెలుసు, వాడు ఎంత యూజ్లెస్ ఫెలోనో తెలుసు, దొర ఎంత కన్నీలు తెలుసు, వాళ్ళ పాలిటిక్స్ తెలుసు, వాళ్ళ ఫ్యామిలీ హిస్టరీ తెలుసు, వాడు అంత తప్పు చేసేటోడు దగ్గర మేము ఎందుకు తగ్గాలి, మేము కరెక్ట్ ఉన్నాం అదే ఈ కాంపిటీషన్ ఎప్పుడు ఉంటుంది. కానీ పుస్తకాలలోకి వచ్చే వరకు, లిటరేచర్లోకి వచ్చే వరకు మొత్తం హైడ్ అయిపోయి దట్ ఈస్ జస్ట్ విక్టిమ్స్, జస్ట్ లేబర్స్, జస్ట్ అన్ఎడ్యుకేటెడ్స్, ఇవన్నీ కూడా పొలిటికల్ ఉన్నా కూడా జస్ట్ రిపోర్టింగ్ సింపతి ఈ రకంగానే రావడం అనేది చాలా లిమిటెడ్. నేను తెలుగు స్టేట్స్లో అది గమనించాను. ఎప్పుడైతే పొలిటిసైజ్ చేయడం మొదలైందో అప్పుడు డిస్క్రిమినేషన్ స్టార్ట్ అయింది. నాకు ఎప్పుడైతే పొలిటిసైజ్ చేయడం మొదలైందో అంతకు నాకు నేను ఎప్పుడు డిస్క్రిమినేషన్ అనేది ఫీల్ కాలేదు. ఆ ఫీలింగ్ మొత్తం స్టోరీస్లో రావాలని నేను రాశాను, ఆ ఫీలింగ్ స్టోరీస్లో రావాలని రాశాను. కానీ ఆ తర్వాత వచ్చే స్టోరీస్ అన్నీ కూడా నేను అంత బాధపడ్డాను, నేను ఇంత బాధపడ్డాను ఇవే ఉంది. అది విక్టిమ్ స్టోరీస్, అందరూ కూడా వాటిని ప్రమోట్ చేస్తారు. విక్టిమ్ స్టోరీస్ ఓన్లీ ప్రమోటెడ్ బై అదర్స్, నాట్ అసర్టివ్ స్టోరీస్. దిస్ ఇస్ ఆల్సో కైండ్ ఆఫ్ పాలిటిక్స్. కాబట్టి దళిత్ హిస్టరీ అన్నప్పుడు ఎస్థెటిక్ హిస్టరీ ఉంది, సెల్ఫ్ రెస్పెక్ట్ హిస్టరీ ఉంది, కానీ బయటికి కనిపించేది జస్ట్ అట్రాసిటీస్ హిస్టరీ. దానికి అందరు సింపతి చూపిస్తారు, అయ్యో పాపం. ఆ పాలిటిక్స్ చాలా ఒక అందుకు నష్టం కూడా బాగా జరుగుతుంది. దానికి న్యాచురలైజింగ్ ద స్లేవరీ, న్యాచురలైజింగ్ ద వైలెన్స్, న్యాచురలైజింగ్ ద ఎనీ పార్ట్. ఆ రకంగా రైటింగ్స్లో ప్రొజెక్ట్ అవుతుంది చాలా. కొంత నేను పర్సనల్గా చాలా డిస్టర్బ్ అయ్యాను అట్లాంటివి ఉండడం వల్ల.
ఇన్ బ్రీఫ్, షీ ఈజ్ ట్రైయింగ్ టు సే దట్ in politics, Dalits are only seen as in a victimized manner, but in her story she tries to bring other factors like Dalit culture, aesthetics, and to give a more human value to what Kala also does. So, yeah. I think I had a response to the media person. One can report a caste violence saying that it's a conflict between anti-caste people and criminal castes like a dominant caste. But I think it makes a lot of difference if you say that this is a struggle between Dalits and upper caste, but anti-caste activists are and dominant caste.
So I would like to respond to your question of like giving an example to yesterday. I mean, we can take Alison through the example. It's a common scene we can take where two colors, black and white, were taken. So in Nayakan, you see, you know, throughout the movie, he put it in, white. Mostly he has shown it in white background, and mostly he portrayed in white color. But usually black is seen as a polluted color and color of labors, right? In Kala Paran, she portrayed it in a different way, where it's a color of leaders from the Dalit communities, color of assertion. So again, the symbols, the symbols that they use and the message that they want to convey. So this example can be, the kind of example that you have asked.
So in addition, because you haven't seen the film, maybe the point that we are making is if you have to address anti-castism through indirect ways, then you are in the aesthetics and culture politics domain basically, because you are not directly pointing it out. So you are, through your energies, through your songs, through your other means, you are changing the meaning that are being associated in a more hierarchical way and to invert those meanings. So if you have seen the film, Marathi films like Saira or Fandri or even Sudhara Kolbe is a photographer and his works. And if you look at the hierarchy between the classical music and folk music, which again Shilpa will talk about, the kind of, there is no one directly talking about caste in either classical or folk, but we really know where the people are coming from who are singing classical and who are singing folk. And the dignity that is associated with it, the economic resources, the state support, all of that is very much, without speaking anything, it's very Brahminical, right? So if we have to challenge it, one is to point it out, but the other is to do what, change the meaning of what folk means and change the dignity that it gets, change the support it gets, those kind of, that level of cultural politics. To respond to how do you perpetuate anti-castism through reporting, I think a good way to look at it is the poetry that Gadar spoke, song of Dalita Pullama. I'll just read a few parts of it and you'll see how he's talking about atrocity but not in a victim narrative. So he says, youngsters resembling heavyweights, well versed in martial arts as well as education, and now he talks about the atrocity. Ask those who belittle and denigrate them to mind their own language. So he's inverting that Christian narrative. They wear sparkling white clothes, move in their hamlet like jasmines. We may not own property, but we have self-respect. When we sip coffee sitting on a chair, rich lords seed with anger. Again, kind of inverting the Christian narrative. We are not living off someone else's father. We are eating on our own money. It is our right. So, just in reporting, if it is can be presented to add to what Hemant is saying, that it's not a victim narrative, it's a resistance narrative. It is something is happening to them which is oppression, but they are not just kind of just taking it, they're responding to it in a very agential way. So that agency to find resistance is something which can be interesting, I feel. Adnan's question of how you look at Pat Parker's poem with what we are saying, in some ways it is similar to, and it's even more important, with questions of race and gender, you know that you cannot ever annihilate it in toto, right? But with caste question, there is an, because it's not, though there are a lot of symbols, but it's still not biologically, there is no biological basis for it at all, right? It's a bad biology. The idea of jati was a bad biology, that okay, we are of different species, but now we know that we are all one human species, right? So that bad biology created those problems. So now we know we have better science to do that. So it becomes even more important for us to think of caste in this way, that we have to forget and not forget at the same time, which is a contradiction, but it can be a productive contradiction, I think, if we look at it from thinking of forgetting casteism and perpetuating anti-casteism.
Yes, in terms of vernacular kind of terms, those are also taken care of in the act in terms of the broad list, but which translates roughly into insults or humiliating and so on, which captures any such terms and abuses. Those are all come under that provision. But this is something that the proponents have claimed, that this is humiliating, this is insulting, this comes under this section, and then the prosecution has to accept, the police have to accept that this is humiliating, and so on and so forth. Using the allegation, I just want to give you one example, because I want to kind of reassert my point, that there was this very well-known case of a Madhiga leader, Krishna Madhiga, MRPS leader in Andhra Pradesh. A well-known newspaper, mainstream newspaper, Andhra Jyoti, published a friend's MRPS story. The story basically runs like this, that these wealth leaders are parasites and they take money from the ruling classes and they're good for nothing. So they are puppets in the hands of ruling classes. So it's a very kind of a derogatory, abusive kind of a front page story that appeared. Obviously, the freedom of expression has taken this form. So then what happened is that this particular group attacked the office and they started from furniture and created some, so that's how they responded. Then the whole debate was about freedom of expression. Then whether somebody can touch media and they can respond, they can debate and so on and so forth. But finally the journalists have taken a huge rally. So in the rally they all went and then the editor also went there. And so they were sitting at some place. Then some form of protest they have discovered. What is the form? They got hold of the photograph of the leader, Krishna Malaya, and they were beating that photograph with chappal. The editor also went and hit the photograph with chappal. So the community leaders, they filed an SAST atrocity act because they were humiliating our leader and so on. And the editor was in jail. But the entire debate was about, not about the humiliation, the hurt feelings of the community, but it's more about freedom of press and the violence of these communities and so on. So this is something that is troubling in the name of freedom of expression and press, of press and so on, in the liberal free speech argument. So this dimension of, you know, what kind of mindset that makes you to pick up, they can protest, they can take a rally, they can do all that. But why do that particular act? So many times, my problem is in terms of that many times we take this kind of a form, which is something that the mainstream upper caste or the mainstream dominant sections, they never see that as an issue. It's illogical to think of that constitutes an offense. This is not an offense and so on. So that is the first point. In terms of the Supreme Court and the judicial class, so it's a very long kind of a debate in terms of the SAST Act, in terms of the reservations in the universities, and in general in this country, so the legal system now thoroughly failed, and after Godoy, it's like a total disaster on any issue. It looks like that they are really working with the government. If you look at the Demokarajo case, and I have personal experience with all the judges, almost whatever the police say, they write, and nothing in the constitution is enforced. And that is the case. And in particularly in the case of SSPs, there is a systematic attempt to at least destroy the legal protections that they have, whether it is in the university education system, or roster system, or the SAST Act. So I think we are in for a kind of great trouble, including destroying the very language that the Dalits have invented for talking about naming this kind of experience, whether Dalit category, or the other attack on Dalit category. I have argued, and that is my firm conviction, that it is the RSS which doesn't want that language to be used. They want something else to be used. As a scheduled caste, if you look at the journal, it's very clear that nowhere they use this term. They use scheduled caste, they use some other kind of terms. And they also use EBC, which is a very convenient way of talking about it. EBC is something like a casteless kind of a category, but the EBC is conveniently again translated into 5% Papus, 5% EBC. 5% jars tomorrow. So that is how the translation is. So as long as the 10% is the dominant upper caste, it is castelessness. If it is SC, it is caste. So the SC or caste-based backwardness is illegitimate. EBC is the norm.
I'm totally focused on the Telangana and Andhra states, the politics of Harijan, how Dalit people are rejected that word. That is a small small section of people. The huge attention on Rama. The BJP people, RSS people wants Rama. Rama has got to all, even SCs also. Why Rama God? Why Rama only God? We have other gods. That's why so many SC people, there is no education, there is no health, no work. first of all, how can they think intellectual way? Some few people only thinking in intellectual way, they have their own perceptions, they are politicizing, they are articulating this way, the culture and God and RSS politics, anti-caste politics. These people are, I think, these few educated intellectual people are representing total community. That's why we have alternate legend, not Rama, Jambava, Jambavanta. Jambava is, he born before land. That is huge story, Jambava Puranam. This Jambava Puranam also very interesting. In the Jambava Puranam, SC, ST, BC, and Sudra upper caste people like Kamma Reddy, these people are also blood related society in Jambava Puranam. I think that is the most important to society. That's why we are claiming our Purana is Jambava Purana. Our God is Jambava, not Rama. Rama always murdered Tata. That's why they presenting always Rama Dashavataras. This is also suppression on ideology of people liberation, people's particularly marginal people. They have their own gods, and why one god? This is secular and diverse culture, diverse gods, goddesses. This is also imposed culture. This is very important. Yeah, some people are, Rama is not God, he is king like all others. Why we are projecting God? The God itself, God concept is totally wrong related to Rama. Rama just king. One period, once upon a time, one period is a only king, he's not God. But these people are making God. Yeah, that discussion also very important. It's going on in the Telugu states. It's a very, very minor way. Thank you. I'm bearing my English. Sorry for doing my English.
Marrying within each other comes from this bad biology that we cannot marry the species, right? So it's coming from that. But that's a more complex kind of interaction between biological and social markers on your bodies. About the victim narrative and finding agency, and I completely agree that there is this modern urgency to find agency everywhere, which is sometimes and doesn't do justice to where, in how subtle forms this is expressed, right? So I would still say that victim narrative creates an object out of humans, of objects of violence, objects of charity, which is not part of annihilating a caste project. It perpetuates casteism in a way that, okay, these are, someone demands our charity and they are just objects of violence. They are not human in the same way. So agency, I understand, can be very subtly expressed, and it's the job of then the scholar or the journalist to be able to do that, to be able to find resistance even in deep moments of violence and exclusion. And this we have seen in the worst of the scenarios, even in Holocaust narratives we found this. It's more about how do you tell that story, and again, because there are such less Dalit voices from media, we don't see that very often. But if you really see a Dalit journalist reporting an atrocity, you will know that it won't be a victim narrative. It would be highlighting all the atrocities, but it will still not be a victim narrative. So I understand where you're saying that, oh, you can use victim narrative to debunk all the reporting on atrocities, but I think we need to really look at how we are reporting, and are we aiding to perpetuation of casteism through that?